To illustrate how enzymes work, we're going to focus on hexokinase. And this enzyme's name can be broken into two parts, hexose and kinase. Now, hexose refers to glucose, which is the six-carbon sugar that we're starting off with. And this makes sense because this enzymatic action that we're detailing is the first step in glycolysis. Kinase means activating enzyme, and basically this says that we're activating the glucose in order to send it on down the pathway of glycolysis. Remember that glycolysis is something that happens before the fueling process gets to the mitochondrion, so hexokinase would be one of the many different enzymes that are present in your cell cytoplasm. In order to complete its job, the enzyme hexokinase must bind to an ATP molecule as well as to a glucose. Now, we would call the ATP and the glucose the reactants in this chemical reaction. The role of the enzyme is to facilitate the rearrangement of the covalent bonds so that, in the end, the third phosphate group on ATP gets broken off of ADP and attached to the glucose. Recall from an earlier lesson that ATP looks like this. There's the adenosine, which is a ribose sugar attached to the base adenine. And this is attached to three phosphates. Now ADP, or adenosine diphosphate, is the same thing, but with only two phosphates. In this reaction, that third phosphate group is now going to be covalently bonded to the glucose, which is now called glucose phosphate. And instead of ATP, we now have ADP. And this new orientation of bonds is favored because it's more stable. What the enzyme hexokinase does is it holds the two reactants, ATP and glucose, in exactly the right way to allow this bond rearrangement to occur. At this point, you might say that this new bond arrangement, the one that you end up with when you have the new molecule, glucose phosphate, and ADP, this is the more stable arrangement that's favored by the natural laws of the universe. So even without the enzyme, this reaction would just naturally happen if you started off with ATP and glucose. And technically, you'd be correct. The problem is that if you started off with just ATP and glucose and no enzyme, you'd have to wait years before even just a few of the molecules bumped into each other in exactly the right way and with exactly the right energy in order to permit this change to occur. The enzyme hexokinase makes this reaction happen just as soon as it can bind to the two reactants, which is very fast. This is basically the way that all enzymes work. They don't really provide any impetus to push a chemical reaction along. It's always some kind of covalent bond rearrangement that would occur naturally if the reactants happen to get into just the right position. But since that right position is so unlikely to occur without any help from enzymes, it just appears like the enzyme is sort of magically making a reaction take place that otherwise would just not be happening. So think of the reaction as something that does happen naturally, but at an abysmally slow rate. The enzyme is just speeding things up, and this is why we call the enzyme a catalyst. By definition, a catalyst is a substance that speeds up the rate of a chemical reaction without being consumed in any way by the reaction itself. The enzyme hexokinase releases the ADP and glucose phosphate, at which point it's free to bind to another ATP and glucose. Another way that people like to talk about the way enzymes work, and this is the way it's explained in your textbook, is to focus on the activation energy of a reaction using a chart like this. The reactants are on the left and are put at a higher position relative to the products shown on the right. This is deliberate to represent the amount of potential energy that's there in the reactants compared to the products. The products have less potential energy because of their covalent bond structure, and therefore the reaction from the reactant to the product is actually favored. However, in order to get from point A on the reactant side to the more stable point B on the product side, you have to go through an intermediate state that has a much higher level of instability. This represents a huge increase in potential energy that the reactants need to overcome before they can get over to the lower energy side of the reaction. And this is what we call the activation energy. In the absence of an enzyme, it would be practically impossible for the reactants to achieve this intermediate state because of the unlikelihood of achieving this level of energy. This relates, in my previous explanation, to that extreme unlikelihood of the ATP and the glucose to bump into each other in exactly the right way for the bonds to rearrange on their own. What the enzyme does is make that intermediate state much, much more likely to occur. Or in other words, the enzyme lowers the activation energy. By making the activation energy relatively easy to overcome, the enzyme is, again, dramatically speeding up a reaction that is really something that happens naturally, albeit at an excruciatingly slow rate. Another enzyme that I've mentioned before, salivary amylase, works in essentially the same way. The reaction starts with large branching chains of glucoses in the form of a starch molecule. Amylase breaks apart the chain, liberating smaller carbohydrates, and it does so by hydrolysis, which is the splitting of water, just like glycolysis is the splitting of sugar. Basically, what the amylase enzyme does is it grabs hold of the starch, and it holds two adjacent glucoses in exactly the right orientation to allow a water molecule to come in and have its bonds rearrange with the one between the atoms that are holding the glucoses together. Now, after the covalent bonds have shifted over into this more stable arrangement, the chain of glucoses has now been broken where the two parts of the split water molecule have inserted themselves. Alternatively, you could say that the broken chain represents a lower energy state relative to the whole starch molecule, but it doesn't get there without overcoming an activation energy. The enzyme amylase helps this catabolic reaction along by lowering the activation energy and making it very, very likely for the water molecule to come in, split, and sever the chain. Now, enzymes are a really, really important part of biology because they're catalyzing all of the chemical reactions that make cells and organisms do all the things that they do. Glycolysis is more than just one step. It's a pathway made up of 10 enzyme-catalyzed steps. Each of the 10 enzymes has its own reactants and products. These steps have a specific sequence in the sense that the products of one step become the reactants for the next step. For example, the glucose phosphate that we end up with after the hexokinase-catalyzed first step is the reactant for the next enzyme in the sequence. At the end of 10 glycolysis steps, we end up with our two pyruvic acids, which in our cells move next to the mitochondria and those parts of the fueling reactions that require oxygen. Also, as you're thinking about the context here of glycolysis, don't forget that in the end, we're producing a net yield of 2 ATP from 2 ADP plus phosphate. And given that glycolysis is a fueling reaction, the net production of ATP is really the whole point. We're going to continue with the fueling reactions in the next video, where we get into all the things that go on inside the mitochondrion.